We are pleased once again to welcome the American anime industry trailblazer, Fred Ladd, to Anime Today. Mr. Ladd was responsible for the English adaptations of such classics as Astro Boy, Kimba the White Lion, Gigantor, and was influential in the production of countless other titles. Welcome back, and thank you very much for taking time to join us today.
Pleasure to be here. Thanks.
And for Anime Today, we've got Nick.
Hi.
Hi, Nick.
Allison.
Hi, Allison.
Hey there.
And I'm Rich. The entire anime world is on the midst of celebrating Astro Boy creator Osamu Tezuka's 80th birthday. Tezuka Productions is posting 700 manga titles and 100 anime titles of Tezuka's work on the company website.
Wow.
It's kind of impressive, isn't it?
Yes, I'll say.
A larger-than-life statue of Astro Boy was recently unveiled at Tezuka's grade school, and the release date of the new CGI Astro Boy draws even closer. The last time we had an opportunity to speak with you, you shared a little bit about your professional relationship with him. What do you think he would have made of this sort of response to his life's work?
Well, I tell you, I was in Tokyo last week. Actually, it was November the 22nd, which is a little over a week now, from this phone call. That day was a day of national celebration. The whole weekend, it was a three-day weekend, which is their equivalent of our Labor Day weekend. They call it Work Day. We call it Labor Day. Mm-hmm. And on Saturday the 22nd, there was in Tokyo a huge day-long celebration held at the second oldest university in Tokyo. The Japanese name of the university escapes me for the moment. But it's the second oldest. It looks like a Western-style, mostly a collection of brick halls, mm-hmm. much as you might find at Harvard or Yale, for example, and classically beautiful. So the folks at Tezuka Productions had actually taken the auditorium there. It's nearly a 1,000-seat auditorium, close to 1,000 seats, most of which were filled with fans of Astro Boy. It was a day-long celebration of Tezuka Osamu Tezuka, and largely celebrating Astro Boy. To my surprise, I had landed at the airport only the night before. Mm-hmm. And to my surprise, I knew we would be going to this day-long celebration at the university. But the surprise came when they announced in the cars we were going over to the site that they'd like to put me on stage to speak with many others about my recollections of Tezuka. Again, I'm going to use the Japanese style of pronunciation, pronouncing the last name first. Mm-hmm. They call him Tezuka Osamu. Mm-hmm. Kind of hard to get used to, but they always put the last name first and then the first name. So if I lapse into that, you'll understand. it was a day-long celebration, as I said. And it began just after lunch, I think at about 1 o'clock their mm-hmm. time. And at about 4 o'clock, they called me to the stage, impromptu, unannounced, because they weren't sure I was going to show or even show in time. Mm-hmm. So, but while I was there, I said, sure, I'd be glad to say something. So I went on the stage and did a lot of talking. The day was celebrating not just the man, but all his various works. As you said, you mentioned a moment ago, all the films that he had created. So clips were shown from all those productions. Each one, I felt a little masterpiece in itself. Mm-hmm. And when it was my turn to speak, I said, "Well, I said here in Japan, we identifying with the audience. Most again, folks we call largely fans. Over here, we celebrate Tezuka Osamu as a great artist. He created this. He created that." And it's easy to forget that with Astro Boy especially, and beginning with Astro Boy, his fame was more than just national, not just here in Nihon, Japan, mm-hmm. but worldwide. And that's why I'm here today, to celebrate and make you aware of what's happened with this great national treasure, Japanese national treasure, mm-hmm. Osamu Tezuka. What's happened with him on a worldwide basis, particularly with English. And I reminded them that... Well, I held my hand up just straight out on a horizontal plane. I said, imagine that my hand is a coin. Well, a coin's got two sides. There's an upside and a downside if you're holding it in this position. So the top side, let's say this is Nihon. This is Japan. And I turned my hand over. I said, but on the other side, you have worldwide. You have international worldwide. And I mean literally worldwide. Let's talk about the West, first of all. You have there's North America, which is the United States and Canada speaking English. UK, United Kingdom, England, Ireland, Scotland speaking English. On the other side of the continent, Hong Kong and Philippines, they speak English. Australia, New Zealand, speaking English. South Africa, they speak English. All of this was done with the works of what started out here as Tetsuwan Atomu. We call him Astro Boy, and he's known as Astro Boy in all the territories of just name. So that you see that as famous and wonderful as Osamu Tezuka is regarded here in Japan, think of the implication worldwide. That is what has happened to this man whose honor we celebrate today. And that went over well with the audience, as you can imagine.
I imagine so. Wow. Well, what do you think he, it is a property that's had just incredible lasting and staying power. Do you think he would have been pleased? Do you think he'd be interested in all of the different things that are going on with his property? I mean, you've got the CG movie coming out. What would he have thought of that?
Well, I think he'd blush a little bit, and he really was a modest guy. He said, "Well, it really wasn't. It was okay, but it wasn't that great. I think it's something akin to what he would say." But he'd been immensely pleased. As we sit here talking, I'm looking at his portrait now on the wall, a big wide grin on his face. That classic portrait. You folks have got a copy of it too, I'm sure. He'd been delighted, and I think surprised. That his fame and that his works have become such worldwide icons, mentioned in the same breath with Walt Disney and Mickey Mouse. It's awesome.
Well, it is completely awesome. Yeah. let's kind of switch gears a little bit and talk about, you have a new and very timely book coming out at the end of this month, Astro Boy and Anime Come to the Americas. Can you tell us a little bit about what we can expect to find in it?
Yes, I can. I'm looking for copies myself, as a matter of fact. Which I had some last night. Last night I gave a talk at the University of Fullerton here in the Los Angeles area. A crowd there of it was supposed to be a student class in animation, but the word got around that I and a couple of other guys who were noted for our works in animation were going to be speaking to this group. So it was a packed, I would say close to 200 folks, who asked me pretty much the same thing. Basically, what it boils down to is that I was, first of all, pushed into doing this thing. I went into reluctantly because I knew it was going to be biting off a lot of time and effort.
Yeah.
And I'm a lazy guy at heart. I just didn't really want to spend all that time and effort at a computer. I'm not computer savvy, first of all. So, but I knew I'd be sitting at the computer just doing a lot of typing, and that's what actually happened.
Yeah.
I was really galvanized into doing it when I got a call. From Tokyo, a little over a year ago, from a fellow who was involved with, actually he's at Sony, and Sony in Japan, Tokyo. He said, "Look, I know it's probably late at night in L.A. It wasn't that late. I said, I'm glad to hear from you. I said, what can I do for you? He said, well, look, I'm sorry to bother you. He said, but we've got questions about Astro Boy, and you're the only one left.
Oh.
Wow. Oh. My answer was, gee, really? I thought we were all dead.
Oh.
So apparently I am the only survivor, and my collaborator on the book, a fellow named Harvey Dinneroff, who is a distinguished animation writer and scholar himself, and who even as we speak is teaching animation in Savannah, Georgia, at Savannah College of Art and Design. It's called SCAD. Has a national reputation. So he's teaching there, and Harvey did a lot to goad me into it. He said, Fred, that call from Tokyo, the guy's right. He said, you really are the last of the Mohicans. You're the last of the guys left who know are in a position to speak with some authority about the Astro Boy phenomenon, which dates back to 1963.
Mm-hmm.
That's the year Astro Boy arrived in these shores. Now, As I say in the book, which I'm looking for myself, by the way, copies, I still don't have the first copy off the press. We were a little delayed. And by the way, the reason for the delay, because the book was due out really by the end of November or very early December.
Mm-hmm.
The reason for delay, what I learned is that I always thought the index to a book was compiled by the publisher. That is not the case. The publisher says, no, you're the writer. The writer, the author compiles the index.
Oh,
I hadn't known that. Are you surprised to hear
task.
That?
That does kind of surprise me a little bit. Yeah. But that's a huge
the publisher
task.
Actually, yeah. So Harvey said, well, I've done this before, Fred, so I'll work up the index. And he did, but because he teaches on a full-time basis at that university in Georgia, his time was precious to him too. He teaches classes, and he just didn't have time. So we were late in getting to the publisher with the index that would complete our manuscript of the book. But that's all there now. It's being printed as we speak. I'm looking forward to be coming off the press any day. The galleys and manuscript have all been returned. So it's just really rolling off the presses now.
Great.
In chapter one, the book opens, once I get to down to talking about how Astro Boy came to the Americas. He came as Tetsuwan Atomu, which means, we would say, iron-armed or iron-fisted Atom Boy. That's how it translates. And my first recollection of that was that in the winter, February, as I recall, of 1963, I got a call from a guy at NBC, and I'm going to make this a very short story because they're just it just goes on and out with all the details. You know what that. But
people are interested, they can also check out your previous two interviews too. It's
well,
all on that website.
I don't want to give
website.
Away too much of the book. There's not all some detail there. About September 7, 1963, it was an overnight sensation, and the rest, as they say, is history.
Well, now there's another show that's covered in your book, Kimba the White Lion, in its own chapter.
Yep.
And of course, everyone knows about the distinct similarities between that and Disney's The Lion King. Could you give us just a little bit of your opinion of what you thought
a
when you...
Bit, with Tezuka, there's no such thing as a little bit. It's voluminous, actually. Well, you've covered a couple of bases. Number one is that off the success of Astro Boy, which went on finally to be 104 episodes, and an astonishing, incredible amount, and still the amount that you've got to beat today if you want to be the syndication champ.
Yeah.
So we finally wound up making, because of the astonishing success of the series, the kids just loved it, obviously. And the initial contract with NBC, as I point out in the book, the initial contract was for 52. That was later expanded to 104 for a variety of reasons. In 1965, a year after the success of Gigantor, another show came in. By this time, the original rep was gone, and a new rep came in from Tezuka Productions. And he had a show about it wasn't a show at that time. It was coming in as really a proposal.
Okay,
it was an elaborate plan, and the plan is published in full in my book. It gives the a copy of the exact documentation, the proposal as it was submitted to NBC. And they looked at it and said, well, this could be kind of interesting. They had reservations about it. But that, as I say, was in 1965. In short, because the proposal, the book takes several pages, believe it or not. It was a lengthy presentation to NBC made by Sabo Tezuka himself, where he laid out the plan. He foresaw 52 episodes of one kind. He had in mind something like 76 or 78 episodes. What he was proposing, and again, now this is 2 years after the arrival of Astro Boy in black and white. He was proposing another black and white series that he was calling Jungle Taitei Leo. They pronounce it Jungle Taitei Leo. Jungle Taitei Leo, it'd be Jungle Emperor Leo.
Yeah.
And his original plan was to have he laid out. By the way, he called each episode a piece. He saw 52 pieces showing the little white lion cub being born, and becoming in his strong years, as Tezuka called them, as growing up to become adolescent, and then finally reaching a stage where he would become, as we say, married. He would find a lovely lioness that we called Kitty, and they would become a couple, and they would have cubs of their own. And toward the end, there, as happens in life, Kimba would die. Now the word Kimba wasn't invented yet; he was still Leo. Mm-hmm. But at the end, he dies.
Drastic departure from normal TV at that point, because you still have the kids' TV shows where they stay in perpetual teenager mode or kid mode for 20 and 30 years. Yeah. That must have been really revolutionary for them to try to grasp that.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And the astonishing thing is not generally known here, but I point out in the book that later on when Tezuka would redo the Astro Boy series in color, mm-hmm. and a new studio he had organized, and he kicked it off mainly with a project he wanted to do. He wanted to do a colored version of Astro Boy, and he did. That series is virtually unknown here in the States. It's known somewhat internationally. But at the end of that series, the color version of Astro Boy, with a young female, he gets sweet. Astro Boy gets sweet on a lovely young girl robot, mm-hmm. who is, in fact, a deadly bomb. In the guise of a lovely girl robot. Mm-hmm. Well, when Astro Boy learns this, he knows that if he were to remain here on the Earth, he is literally a ticking time bomb of cataclysmic proportions. Mm-hmm. That would be the end of the Earth. Not mm-hmm. wanting that to happen, Astro Boy takes the lovely young girl robot, and they fly through space. They fly into the sun. There, the super bomb detonates. And that's the end of Astro Boy 2, by the way. He dies. Astro Boy dies at the end. This is not generally known. I pointed it out here in the book. But that's a life truism that is accepted as part of the culture in Japan. Mm-hmm. We don't do that here in the States or in what I loosely call the West. Relating it to Kimba, NBC's position was, Tezuka, you're a nice guy, but we don't know what you're talking about here. You lost us, kid.
Oh.
First of all, black and white, forget black and white. This is 1965. Mm-hmm. NBC Network is going into color now after doing it on a limited basis until now. We're going full-time into color. In Japan, you're selling us to the Fuji Network, and the Fuji Network, like NBC, is also going into full-time color casting, no more televising in black and white. Mm-hmm. It's going to be all color. Therefore, it's clear that in Japan, your own basic bankroller, and we here in the States, you've got to make it in color. Forget black and white. If you're only going to do black and white, thanks a lot. Have a great life. We're out of here. There's no interest here in it. This meeting is over. Nothing mm-hmm. more to talk about. So, number one, you got to have color. As I explained to the audience in Tokyo a couple of weeks ago, Ichi, number one, is color. Mm. Ni, second, if you're talking about animals in the jungle and the law of the jungle, mm-hmm. That's a problem, folks, because you're talking violence. Mm-hmm. And if you're talking about having animals fight to the death on camera, and we see blood and gore all over the place, and vultures coming down swooping, we're going to have to pass because we can't show that violence here. Mm-hmm. Now, if they're going to be off in the jungle somewhere, hidden in the trees, and we hear the sound of all these fights taking place, but we don't see any dead animals, we don't see gore, we don't see blood, we don't see vultures feeding off carrion. If you could conceal it off screen, that's something that we could work out with Fred. We'll work that out. That's mm-hmm. our second condition. There's one more condition. Sound, three. Condition three is that you're talking about 52 episodes in which the little white lion would mature and have his own family and die at the end. Out. No way.
Hmm.
52 episodes, you've got to keep. We're going to call the little lion something else. It won't be Leo. We'll work that out with Fred. We're going to need you to have 52 episodes and no more than 52. You're talking about 76? No. We'll go for 52. In color. No visible violence. And the little cub stays little cub from beginning to end. He doesn't grow up in this series. Now, what you do after that is your affair. If you want to go on with it, that's something else. But well, we cannot have an adult lion that is mortal and dies at the end. No, we just have to rework that. You could do that, can't you? Sure you can. Call us when you're ready. Jessica was not happy about that at all.
He
got pretty disappointed at him, and in fact, looked at me. There's a cartoon that he drew that we showed in Tokyo. I hope it's going to be in my book. I'm not sure that it is. It may be out at the last minute. But it's a drawing made by Tezuka where he showed the two top guys at NBC sitting in a room on one side with him, Tezuka, on the other side, and a sketch of me in the middle. It looks so darn much like me, I can't figure out how we did it. And it looks so much like the other two guys. It was clear that Tezuka had a mind that was like a camera.
Wow.
Once he got a mental image of you, that was his own fashion. He actually drew the other two guys. The other two guys were a fellow named Bill Schmidt of NBC, who loved Astro Boy. And the other fellow was a man named Rittenberg. They were the two top guys in this division. And they were saying to him, look, we're doing very well with Astro Boy. Tetsuka wrote it in Japanese, of course. What it meant in English was, look, we're well pleased. Astro Boy's doing well here. What are you working on now? Tetsuka, the other side of the room, says, well, I'm working on a little white lion in the African jungle. It takes place in Africa. And I'm in the middle, looking, smiling at Tezuka. I'm exactly halfway in the drawing between Tezuka on the right and the two NBC guys on the left.
Mm-hmm.
That's how we saw it, because when the guys laid down the law to him and said, yeah, we like the idea, but you got to drastically change it. We can't go along with your proposal. Well, if you can go along with ours, we think we can make a deal. And later on, Tezuka would look to me to say, look, I can't do what they want. Can't you go to them? We're together. You did Pinocchio and stuff with him. We're friends. And can't you go back to them and turn them around? All I could do to turn him around was to say, look, Tezuka, here's what you got to do. And by the way, he called me Lad. Never Fred or Fred-san or Mr. Lad. It was Lad. Lad, can't you speak for me? Maybe by advocate, in effect. I said, well, here's what I probably could do. You want to do 76 or 78 episodes, pieces as you call them. Can't you do 52 where the lion stays a baby all the way through? But beginning with episode 53, which wouldn't involve NBC at all, can't you then have him grow up and have his own cubs and die at the end if you want him to? That's something else. That we could probably work.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, in fact, exactly what happened.
Mm-hmm.
It did take place just that way. Tezuka, it was a compromise, but Tezuka did indeed make his 78 or 70, I think it was 78 pieces. 52, and I think he made 26 extra, so that'd be 78. He made his 78 pieces. And indeed, our Kimba does grow up, and I think he perishes at the end. I'm not even that much, that sure. But our series, and the one distributed by The Right Stuff, is the original 52, and they all go out with the NBC imprimatur at the end. And that was in 1965. It began in 65, mm-hmm. 1965. And we were making the English version well into 1966 and maybe even to the very beginning of 67, but certainly through 1966, we were creating Kimba the White Lion.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can I tell you some things you didn't know?
You sure
yeah,
did.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, I think a lot of fans will be kind of surprised to hear there was so much give and take back and forth between the American
mm-hmm.
side and the production company, because a lot of the fans, I'm on the message boards all the time, they kind of have an idea that, you know, the collaboration and the co-production kind of mentality is something really pretty new, when actually it kind of goes back all the way back to anime appearing on TV,
mm-hmm.
you know,
exactly
dating
right.
that far back.
Exactly right.
You're talking a little bit about how Tezuka, you know, had been influenced by other people. And do you think, you know, going back to the question about The Lion King, do you think it's a kind of a situation where there's a cultural trade where he was influenced by some things with Astro Boy, like Pinocchio, and then in return later on, many, many years later, the animators and people who were then connected with the more recent production, like the Disney production, were then influenced by that. And it's more kind of a cultural exchange rather than some of the things that the fans automatically attribute it to.
Yeah. I think you're asking me about what I spoke about last night that at the university. I was indeed asked, and I wasn't surprised because it keeps coming back even after all these years.
Mm-hmm.
Is The Lion King a ripoff of Kimba the White Lion, that was on television 30 years before The Lion King was, you know, was even really seriously considered as a project for Disney. It began again. I'm going to try to shorten it. I got a call. The whole thing came to me as a problem when back in 1994, I got a call from a reporter in San Francisco who said that a lot of fans, irate fans, are actually devastating. They had police out to control the crowd.
Wow.
It was a big flap there. They were irate fans devastating, booing the theater, showing The Lion King. They had all gone to see it, these fans of Kimba. They went to see The Lion King, expecting, because of some of these striking similarities to Kimba the White Lion, expecting to see Osamu Tezuka credited at the end. He wasn't even mentioned. They said, my God, this is a ripoff, an uncredited ripoff. At least if they'd have given a bow, a nod to Osamu Tezuka, who obviously influenced the production of this picture. Mm-hmm. But that didn't happen. Mm-hmm. So they were irate, and this reporter wanted to know, what did I think of it? I hadn't seen the picture yet. He called me on a weekday. It was the end of a week. And I'm a member of a television academy that was going to be showing the picture that weekend. I said, well, I'm going to be seeing it with my wife this weekend. Let me see it. I don't know what you're talking about. Let me see it, and then I'll get back to you. Well, we could talk next week. I did go to see the picture, and as I sat there in the audience watching the screening, I saw a little, well, first of all, the whole idea of the little lion being born at the very beginning is just the way the Kimba pilot opens. The birth of Kimba is in show number one. There was a visual similarity there. All the animals are flocking to the scene where the birth had taken place. And I thought, well, it's a lovely opening. The Disney opening is spectacular. And I'm a big Disney studio fan. Mm-hmm. So I saw an elderly baboon appear. Looked a lot like our dad old baboon in Kimba. But what the heck, you've seen, one such baboon, you've seen them all. The jungles are full of them. So you can't say Disney rips it off. I mean, my gosh, you know.
Yeah.
No, you can't say that they copy that. And I just missed that. Then a talking bird came in, a raucous talking bird. It wasn't a parrot as in Kimba. It was a different kind of bird. But it had the same dramatic role as the parrot in Kimba, just as the baboon in The Lion King, had a similar dramatic role as an elderly advisor and counselor to the young white cub. So the dramatic roles were the same. But even so, I said, well, so what? Yeah, I mean, you know, these are jungle animals, and no one's got a monopoly on them. Tezuka didn't invent those animals any more than Disney did, so what the heck? But then the third thing that came along was there were a pair of hyenas. Mm-hmm, and they were smart-ass hyenas. Now, there were three in the Disney feature. There are two in the Kimba thing. But their roles are identical. They are servants. They grovel at the feet of the evil brother of the Jungle King. We called that lion, that evil lion, we called him Claw. I think he's called Scar.
Yep, in
the Disney version. But he had the same influence now, and that's pretty close to Kimba's, what I thought. and I could even overlook that, but there was one thing I could not overlook, and I'll tell you exactly what it is. To me, the telltale thing, and then you draw your own conclusions, and your listeners are welcome to do the same. There's a scene in Kimba. It's a signature shot. It's so distinctive and unique. It was stunning the first time I saw it in Kimba in 1965. And it still dazzles me today. And it has emerged over the years as like a trademark of Kimba. If anything symbolizes it, it's that image. That image is there's a fight in both the Kimba series and in The Lion King. Where the young, the courageous young lion now comes out of the fight victorious, and he marches out to a rocky promontory, silhouetted as a dark, almost black shadow against a brilliant orange sky, you know. It's a stunning image. Well, the lion stands out there in his full pride, no pun intended there. And then the camera pans up from him up to the clouds. And in the clouds, you see the image of the dead father, of Kimba's dead father, who lets his son below know that that the son did well.
Mm-hmm.
Well, when I saw the young lion, Simba, it's called Simba in the Disney version. Mm-hmm. Our young lion, you know, was Kimba. They took the name Simba, which is the name I wanted for our little lion, but was overruled. Simba is Swahili, as far as I know. It means lion. And I wanted to call our little lion Simba, but was overruled. That's a separate story. So it became Kimba instead of Simba. Mm-hmm. And then what we saw in the Lion King, now, mind you, after seeing all these remarkable similarities earlier in the film, when the young lion now, and Lion King walks out of the rocky promontory. I leaned over to my wife and said, my wife and I leaned, I said, gee, don't tell me they're going to pan up to the clouds. We're going to see the. And as I said it, the camera began panning up. I said, I can't believe this.
You're look like, oh, no, they don't.
Oh, my gosh. Now, that is such a distinctive signature idea. I can't foresee any two artists coming up with the exact same idea. And that said to me, oh, my God, they are ripping off Kimba the White Lion. This is, that's unmistakable. No two artists could independently come up with the exact same idea.
Okay.
So I felt that it was more than just coincidence, Alice. It had to be, the similarity was there.
Okay.
Yeah, Allison, have I made that clear? Do you
that
follow?
That totally
oh, yes.
Answered the question.
Does that answer your question about two guys independently getting the same idea?
Totally does. Yes, it does.
Okay, all right.
Well, you know what? It's one of the things. It's possible, but it's become a meme, you know, within the community, and it's not backed up very well a lot of times when people pop it out there. So specific examples are good.
There you go. So while in theory it could have happened. Mm-hmm. In practice, I don't think it ever would.
Okay.
Well, your book touches on the new anime industry, and new, I mean in quotes, the new anime industry. Is there one moment or show that you would identify as the touchstone that audiences began to get reintroduced to anime? And why do you think audiences responded that particular way to a certain title or to a certain show?
Well, okay, I'm going to call the Golden Age the 1960s, where after Astro Boy and Gigantor and Kimba, Marine Boy came in 1967. We had like the end of 66, Marine Boy came. Mm-hmm. That came out of my shop, but I did no hands-on on it. Then came Speed Racer, the anime series. That came in 1967. And again, I had no hands on, but it came out of our shop and it's got our stamp on it, you know. Now, after that, there was a lull in my way of thinking. Throughout the 70s, the Japanese animation became increasingly violent and was increasingly hard to program. Things were offered over here that that NBC just wouldn't touch it. And NBC by that time was already backing away because of government regulations that were independent. But still, they felt they weren't missing anything because Tezuka wasn't coming up with anything that they were interested in, and whatever else was out there during the 70s was violent. Until the end of the 70s, along came a thing that was called Battle of the Planets. Now, that came in 1979. It was offered to me, and I turned it down. For the first time in my life, I was walking away from a project. Now, Battle of the Planets, came in from a guy who had gone to a rival studio, rival to Tezuka, but was being formed and run in the Tezuka style because Tezuka had set the pace. Everybody said, gee, Tezuka found a way to be a success in the West, in the Americas and in Europe, in the West, as opposed to the Far East where Japan is. So everybody said, well, we're just going to do what Tezuka did, and we're sure to succeed. They were partly right. A studio called Tatsunoko had put out a series that they called Gatchaman. And the Gatchaman series was acquired by an outfit in New York, a distributor in New York. An ex-NBC producer had gone off on his own, set up his own distribution company. And like this series that he saw coming out of the Tatsunoko studio, the Gatchaman series, he wasn't going to call that Gatchaman any more than Jungle Emperor Leo became the Kimba series. It just wasn't that kind of commercial title. But he liked the action. He liked the styling. He liked the action. You saw five teenage cadets, I'll call them, who were fighting crime. And they were a scientific team, according to the Japanese perception. So the Gatchaman, he took the Gatchaman series. He took a total of actually 85 episodes, 85 half hours, all very well animated, very good looking. And he was going to call them Battle of the Planets, which is the title he went with. In fact, there were no other planets in the series, and there weren't any planetary battles. Mm-hmm. So that was a problem. But it was a great title. He sold it off the title. By that time, Star Wars was already, making a big splash. 1978, you remember, Lucas came out with Star Wars, so the source time, yep. The big thing, a planetary war, and all that kind of thing. I turned it down because, I knew there was a lot of violence in it. And when I asked about doing the script, I had gotten a phone call from the office of a New York licensor. Mm-hmm. And he said, I said, how's the script going to be handled? How do you want to work this? If we have these things you're talking about, about the script, and then the guy in New York assured me, he said, look, he said, by that time I was already in Los Angeles. The guy said, don't worry about the script, Fred. We're going to have the script written by our own guy in California. I said, excuse me? He said, yeah, we'll have the script written. You won't have to bother with the script. What do you want, without the script? I said, I'm not getting this. You're going to have it written, but does the guy out there have any, is he an experienced dubbing writer? Is he used to doing this kind of thing? To which he has to say, no, and he told me who the guy was. He was a Hanna-Barbera animator, a guy I knew. I didn't know him well, but I knew of him. A top-notch animator who was going to be writing the English script, the dubbing script. I got concerned. I said, what about this? What about that? And the answer was, look, Fred, what are you going to... Fred, cartoons is cartoons. Cartoons is cartoons. Okay, thanks very much. Phil, I appreciate the call, but I'm going to have to turn you down. It's just not going to work. Because I can already see what's going to happen. I just know I'm going to get my feet wet. We're going to go to the studio. Lip sync, he's inexperienced at it. It's not going to work. I'm going to be doing some rewriting on the floor. We used loops in those days. But in every single section here, I'm going to have to be doing some rewrite. And whereas our day normally has to end at 5:30, I could see me being here till 8:30, 9:30, 10 o'clock at night with all these revisions. And Phil, I appreciate it. I just can't. So if you're committed to this this writer, you go ahead. And listen, I wish you all the luck. Have a great life. Goodbye. And for years afterward, I said, I should just have blown the way I did. I should just thought it through a little bit better. But what happened miraculously, and now mind you, we're talking about the end of the 70s. In Nicolau's Battle of the Planets, I'll go back to the 70s because this is your question. But what happened chronologically? At the end of the 70s, as I say, I turned this down, it went out as Battle of the Planets, and the syndicate, the licensor, sold the pants off it. But it went out of the air and it bombed almost immediately. The kids couldn't follow it. There was so much violence in the show that the so-called writer that he had out here in California had to cut the violence out. And there was so much violence that whereas he should have had a half-hour show, he was winding up with about 12 minutes violence-free. there aren't a lot of 12-minute time slots. Either you got a half hour or you don't. So they actually had to, for Battle of the Planets, they actually had to animate new sequences to replace the ones that were cut to bring the shows up to length. And they invented new characters. They had a robot dog, character called Seven, Doc Seven. and mm-hmm. and there were other, it was like a subplot going on, and the two elements apparently didn't mesh. So the kids found it confusing. They lost it. But renewal time came. The New York distributor could not get renewals. So he wound up making a deal with Turner Broadcasting. They took it on. And a guy who liked my work from Astro Boy and Kimba called me after Turner had acquired that series, Battle of Planets. I said, look, Fred, we'd like you to undertake this and so forth. I said, wait a minute, are you referring to, and I mentioned a different series. He said, no, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the Tatsunoko series. You're not talking about Battle of the Planets, are you? He said, yeah, that's exactly. I said, well, then I told him what I've just told you guys in Des Moines. Mm-hmm. He said, no, he says, we're not asking you to take the old series and patch it up, say what's good and replace what's bad and do your best to patch it up. But no, we're not. We want you to take it back to its original version as it came from Japan and redo it from scratch. And the guy this is a guy in Atlanta, Georgia, at Turner. And mm-hmm. I said, Hank, you're talking about throwing away 85 half-hour shows and soundtracks and going back to ground zero, building it again? That's exactly what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. I said, Hank, if that's what you're talking about, it's like, you know, the old biblical story, Moses got a second chance. Hank, I think you're offering me a second chance to do that series from Tatsunoko. So, well, that's we like it. So, will you do it? Mm-hmm. There were some other negotiations in between. I showed him what I would do. I made a couple of samples for him, taking the two hardest shows in the 85 half hours, the talkiest, most complicated shows, and showing him what I would do with it. We sent him those, the Fred version. They said, okay, you got a green light. Go ahead and do the series. So it went out again from Turner under the title G-Force. And it went on, and I look back at it kind of fondly. We must have done something right because now there's a studio here in town with its plant, and here in town is here in California, here in Los Angeles. The studio is called Imagi. Have you heard of it?
Mm-hmm. Sure have.
Okay. Imagi, as we
pretty speak, hard not to if you're an Astro Boy fan.
Yeah,
that's right. Exactly right. What I do with Astro Boy, as we speak, I've become a kind of an advisor ex officio to them. I'm in constant contact with them. It's a delight. Mm-hmm. So, the work I'm seeing coming out of there so far is just beautiful. It's great. The feature is due to open October 23rd, 2009. Now, the next year, in 2010, they're already to work on Gatchaman, the very show that I converted back from its Japanese title and origin into G-Force. Now it's not going to be exactly the G-Force as we released it, but they're making that adventure. So I've kind of got a parental interest in both series, and that's for that series is scheduled for release in 2010.
Mm-hmm. So going back to Astro Boy for just a second, what do you think of the changes that they're already making to the show for this movie?
I haven't seen a lot of it so far, but so far, again, I've just seen some what they call a sizzle reel stuff. I've seen some of the outstanding shots. Some of it I know is already on the web, as a matter of fact.
I just saw the new trailer the other day.
Gorgeous, is it not?
Oh, it's beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
You see the sequence where you see Astro Boy flying up into the clouds and circling and pivoting around and coming through, and then his lights come on like searchlights.
Yeah.
He starts furrowing into a mountainside.
Exactly.
Yeah. I think it's great. My wife poses a question. She says, well, she thinks it's good. She says, but she wonders if Tezuka, interesting question. She wonders if Tezuka would have liked it or hated it.
Yeah, I was kind of wondering that same thing, because Astro Boy had a hat on and shoes and a sweatshirt on and everything.
Yeah, okay. My wife raises the question. Those are good points. Go another step, and with Tezuka, a devotee of two-cell animation with pen and pencil.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Would he have liked a digital transformation of his character, beautiful as it is to look at? Would he, as a purist, she suspects he was a purist more than I think he was. But it's academic, we'll never know, you know. So I think he would love this. She says she thinks he would have hated it. simply because it wasn't a guy holding a pen in his hand and drawing out paper and ourselves. Mm-hmm. I don't know. It's kind of a fine point. We'll never know that answer, but it's an interesting question.
Yeah, it is.
So moving on to another kind of updated anime title, did you get a chance to see the Wachowski brothers' updated live-action Speed Racer?
I did. Nick, are you posing the question?
No, nope, this one's Rich.
Is that Rich talking?
Yeah, this is Rich.
This is Rich. Okay, so was your question Rich?
Yes.
If you will, let me get to that in just one more second, because you talked about a decline and a rebirth. As I told you, I think the rebirth began really in 1979 with 1979 was Battle of the Planets, actually, and then
you're talking about G-Force.
In G-Force, yeah.
That's exactly right. Speed Racer came along in the first thing I saw of what became Speed Racer was in 1967. And I thought it was a winner right from the start. I wish I could have acquired that as I acquired what became Gigantor. That didn't happen. My partner died at the end there. Just that was coming in. I had a full plate. I just couldn't. The show came out of our shop, but I couldn't do any hands-on as I would like to have done. But as I told you, there was a decline during the 70s, a rebirth at the end of the 70s, and then going into the 80s, I imagine you had Robotech coming along at that time, you know, the Robotech series. And then for Robotech, it took off in the 80s, became again a rebirth of animation. You had Voltron coming along, and the Japanese wave was the second wave was coming in. Rich, does that answer your question? Your earlier question?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, Speed Racer. I thought the Speed Racer was a marvelous series. I love the animated series. I love the influences in it. There were tweaky things that I never thought about in American animation. Racer X, for example, a mysterious racer who was actually Speed's older brother. I thought that the animated series was so tweaky and so unique, un-American, and I don't mean it in an unfriendly way. I mean, so different from the way we think about cartoons here. I thought, gee, there's so many tweaky elements here, again, like that mysterious racer and other surprise elements there that I would never have thought would ever find their way into animation. I love this series, and I was just sorry that I don't own it today. The Wachowski brothers obviously were fans of the show, and what they did was they were so sure that Speed Racer is so well remembered today by guys who were kids when that series first came out in anime, but who are adults today with their own generation of kids that they want to see it. The Wachowski brothers were sure that they could build a live action feature out of it and sell it, get the financing for it, because it wasn't going to be a cheap picture to make. It was full of special effects, which are very, very expensive. Mm-hmm. So what they did was they actually assembled, they built, not commonly known, they put together a 4-minute demo. They took their own dough and got whatever dough they could to make a razzle-dazzle sizzle reel. We use that term here. Mm-hmm. only 4 minutes. Showing some great, great special effects, you know, the car racing and all and Speed behind the wheel. Powerful. They showed the first, by the way, I will tell you, at Comic-Con. They snuck it in to get some audience reaction, and they had some guys from Warner Brothers there, guys who didn't come out just to see that, but they knew the Warner Brothers guys were there. So they arranged to sneak a 4-minute piece at Comic-Con. What was it? The year was, I think it was 2003 or 4. I forgot the year, but they showed it at Comic-Con. And the kids at Comic-Con went crazy over it. How could you not? It was when you saw the car racing and pivoting and turning and flying over hurdles. What's not to like? You know, it was dazzling. Mm-hmm. The Warner Brothers saw it. They took the 4-minute piece back to Warner Brothers. They all speeded over there. They knew that the name Speed Racer is still a name that's current. You know, there was a series of 1964 called 8-Man. Forgotten. You never hear about it. But Speed Racer is remembered. You mention Speed Racer to anybody, it's a magic title. So knowing that the guys at Warner's knew and loved the Speed Racer anime that they saw when they were kids, because the Warner Brothers guys are fairly young guys themselves. So they based on that, and seeing the audience go crazy for it at Comic-Con, I said, we're going to go with you, Wachowski brothers. It's a go. Let's do this. We haven't got all the dough. It's still kind of risky, and we're just not doing 100% financing anymore. But we'll put up X number of bucks. If you can get some other bucks elsewhere, you're going to show it to other territories. You give us North America, and you give us certain territories, and we'll give you so many dollars for that territory. That'll leave you free to go to the other territories that we're not claiming, and make your deal with them. And somehow you can, if you get enough bucks, come back to us, and we're with you. We love what we see. Well, the Wachowski brothers got money from Germany, and they shot the picture of Germany, as you probably know. By the way, do you remember the opening of the picture? Do you remember in one of the races, you saw a guy on a narrator calling one of the races, a sportscaster.
Yeah, he was one of the announcers.
One of the announcers, a guy wearing a horn and glasses. That was Peter Fernandez, the guy who was in my shop and who actually did the actual production on the anime series just for laughs. They called him in. And he was over in Germany. He went over. They shot this in a little town in Germany. But the Germans put up some money for it. They got some other territories to put up. And taking the Warner Brothers money and the German money and other territories, they then had the money to go ahead and do the show. Now the film, as you know, bombed at the box office, a huge disappointment. They thought it was going to be the big, what they call a tentpole picture for the summer. And really, go smash all attendance records. It did bomb. I myself am not sure why. Pundits, you read Variety, and every writer's got a different opinion as to why I didn't make it. But I went to see it. Sorry, I liked it.
I loved it. I really did.
I thought it was great. Now, were there any surprises? Mm-hmm. No, it was predictable. But I was looking over the production of 52 anime shows from 1967 to 1970. So there were no surprises. Mm-hmm. I knew what to expect. I thought the kid Emil Hirsch, was Speed Racer, the live action actor. I thought he was. I'm looking for big features of my guy. I thought he was wonderful in the part. I thought he was great. By the way, for what it's worth, Corrine Orr, who was the voice of Chim Chim and Spritel in the anime series, Corrine has got a screen credit. They took one of her lines from the picture, from the series, and used it in the picture. She gets a screen credit. And her reaction when she saw the premiere was, well, she thought that Susan Sarandon and
John Goodman.
Goodman, thank you. John, they thought they were too old to be the parents of young of young Ava. I didn't even think of that. Who the heck cares? But but the whole picture was predictable to me. But I knew what to expect. I thought it was a blast. Kids were disappointed. Audiences were disappointed. So the picture didn't do well at all. It didn't get back its negative cost. They've lost money so far. But as I look at it, I think the guys at Warner's will agree that in time it will recoup its negative cost and go to profit, because there's going to be a DVD sale out of it. They're going to make video games, what we call ancillary uses, subsidiary rights. And I think down the road it'll be a winner. But it may take years to recoup, but I think that's going to happen. I
think it's one of those movies that, too, as people are upgrading their TV sets to HDTV and getting the Blu-ray players, it's one of ones that people will use and look at as like, whoa, this is the high quality and something to show off.
I'm sure it's gorgeous.
Yeah, because it's gorgeous.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, the way the picture was faulted, the race, nobody thought the race scenes were all they could have been. You didn't feel that the competition was any threat. He didn't have any. Now they did say the brother, the racer X, that came through. I thought that actor was good. I thought the picture was well cast. But again, the race, they say, had no thrills to it, because you never really believed that Speed was in any trouble or doubted that he was going to win the race. So that was the biggest thing they threw against it. Well, again, I watched the production of 52 episodes. you know, I knew what to expect.
You know the score, and you know he's going to win because he's a speed racer.
I thought the picture was well made and loved it. I've only got good things to say about it.
You had mentioned that you were doing some consulting work with Imagi. Can you tell us anything about, is there anything that's not top secret that you can tell us about what it is that you're doing with them?
Well, they're coming to me for, all right, this isn't top secret. This is, I sent them over a lot of materials that I thought would tweak their curiosity, and they did. None of you guys was at Comic-Con this past year, were you? In San Diego. All right, they had a booth there, and I dropped in unexpectedly. I was at Comic-Con, and when they knew I was there, they were doing a little show, just by luck. I get there just so they're doing a show, and so I suddenly find myself for the show. But they were doing.
That happens a lot to you, doesn't it?
Yeah, in a way, it's nice, but in a way, I'm saying, gee, you know, hey, I am what I am. I know how old I am, and give me a break, will you? Leave me alone. I'm tired. But it's fun. It's stimulating. I got there just as they were having this little trivia quiz, and the fun for me came when the gal leading the trivia quiz asked the audience, "Who here knows? Show hands. Who here knows when Astro Boy first premiered?" As Astro Boy here in America. And there was one guy guessed 1970, 19, all kinds of guesses. And from the edge of the crowd, I yelled out, September 7, 1963. So the gal named Alex from Imagi. She walked over and she got tweaked. She looked at my badge. She said, "Oh my God." So she said, "Oh my God." That's the other seat. "Ladies and gentlemen, this is Fred Lab, blah, 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 blah." And so I took over the little quiz from there, and I told the question, how did it start? And what I have said over to Imagi since is that some NBC publicity releases, and I know that Sean Kleckner has a copy. I made sure I sent him a copy. NBC publicity releases with the NBC logo up at the top, and it was a comparative rating. It was an industry document. It was to send out to other stations and things. It showed, as a sales tool, it showed the ratings of all the shows on the air on that night of September 7, 1963. Astro Boy was a top-rated one. I think the rating was a Nielsen rating, 8.4. And everything, including Superman, was something behind it. It was a top-rated one. Mm-hmm. Well, of course, NBC would yell it from the housetops, you know. So they did that, and there was a follow-up week where again, Astro Boy was top-rated. Now, that was tremendously helpful to the NBC salesman, as you could expect. They took those around to the individual station. They said, "Look, here's a winner, and you can have it for only X number of bucks, a bargain. Take it out before I show it to the guys across the street because they want it." And it was, you know, sold phenomenally. So I sent that over to them. So the next question was, "Fred, you know how to do it South America?" Well, I didn't have any official ratings for that, but I gave them stories of how I know it did in Guatemala and how it did in Mexico City in the Spanish version, where, to Imagi's surprise, the Spanish version they're showing, but the Spanish version... The characters are not called Tetsuwan Atomu or Jungle Taitei Leo. It's Astro Boy and Kimba. Now, the characters speak Spanish, and the Spanish is translated not from the Japanese original, but from the English script. This is largely because the translators down there don't speak Japanese, but almost all of them speak at least a little English, you know.
Okay.
So they found it a lot easier to translate the English script, which is that they had a lot more humor in it than the Japanese. Which delighted Tezuka. He hadn't expected all that humor and loved it. That was one of the things that made us a kind of close friend. He said, "You saw humor here that I didn't see." He pointed out. He was a very, very nice guy. So he called me the godfather of Astro Boy. That's where that title came
from. Wow.
That's a compliment.
I recognize it as such. Godfather of Astro Boy. And... by the way, you heard the opening song, which doesn't exist or didn't in the Japanese version. Mm-hmm. That was an American invention. He didn't know we were going to do that. When he first saw it, his jaw dropped. He loved it. He loved it so much that he got on the phone and he called back to Japan. Do you know the story, Allison?
Yeah, actually, he told it to us the last time that we spoke.
Okay, well, I'm not gonna, yeah. No, good. Hey, stop me if I start to ramble. I forgot. But just let me give you one more bit of stuff. He said, what am I doing with the emoji? They wanted to know, what are the lyrics, the English lyrics off a song we just discussed? What are the English lyrics to that song that we composed? They were trying to get it off the soundtrack, and they weren't quite sure. So they copied it as best they could. But it was there were at least a half dozen errors that I corrected, mm-hmm. and they went back. So they appreciated that. Thanks a lot. So they would probably want to use that somewhere in the picture. And just to wrap up about the music. So Allison, but he said, "Lad, he says you're the godfather of Astro Boy."
Aww.
I said, "Arigato gozaimasu. Thank you, Demo, mm-hmm. Bud." Tetsuka said, "You are the father of Tetsuwan Atomu." I mean, you got all I did was teach the character to speak English. I appreciate the compliment, but you know, I knew what I had done. But again, he is the creator. He's the originator, and all heaps of praise go to him. I'm looking at his picture right now on the wall. So yes, that was that's how that started. The Australians, by the way, enlarged it to Godfather of Anime. That's where that came from. That came from the Australian distributors.
Well, with everything coming out, with your book coming out at the end of this month, and with all of the Astro Boy stuff going on over the next year, do you have any messages you'd like to put out there for all the fans listening today?
Well, I'm going to be watching for the premiere of this picture, which I expect to be wonderful. It's being directed by a guy named David Bowers. Bowers is a top-notch director. He came from England. In fact, he's based here in Los Angeles. I'll come to that in a second. But Bowers was in England for a while. He worked on the Aardman picture, Flushed Away. He's got a wonderful sense of humor, and I'm looking for big things from him. In their offices, they show me their styling of other characters that maybe you haven't seen so far. By the way, there's a real quick clip of them on the web in that piece that you saw before.
Okay.
But it goes by very, very quick, but I'm sure it's meant to be Dr. Elephant.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I remember that, yes.
It goes so fast. They keep your name Dr. Elephant, which is my name. But in a case where they didn't know some of the other names, they've kept the Japanese name, and I'm sorry that they've done that. I said, you're going to get letters from fans about this, because this is what we call that character in English. But it's too late. They've already recorded all the soundtracks. It would be a major, major job for them. So they said, and some of the stuff I knew they got from Tokyo, and Tokyo didn't even know the English names, you know. So I don't want to, you know, it could be counterproductive. I just didn't want to make those waves. I said, if you could do some retakes, Nicolas Cage is in the voice cast. Donald Sutherland. Bill Nye, I think, is in this. As others, who are some of the other characters? There's a guy named Freddie Highmore who plays the voice of Astro Boy.
Those are the big names, and I think Kristen Bell, who's on Heroes, is in there.
Yeah,
exactly.
Kristen Bell, right. I remember that.
That's exactly right. Yeah, he's in it too. That's exactly right.
You got most of the ones I remembered.
That's right. No, you're right, Allison. And with Bowers directing it, I don't know how it could be a miss. Now, I made a point out of Dr. Elephant because out of all the character sketches I saw here in the Los Angeles offices of Imaji. And by the way, the actual work is being done, as you know, in Hong Kong. You know, they do it by teleconference. You aware of that? They teleconference every day, and they show character designs and they'll put this line here and that line there. And it's always being updated, so it's amazing how it's being done. So David's here in Los Angeles. I saw the rendering of Dr. Elephant here, just a sketch of him that they showed in their offices. I look at him. I can't believe this is so good. I can't believe it. You know, as Tetsuka has always drawn the character we call Dr. Elephant, he's got this outside schnoz, the nose on it, you know, which is why it's so elephantine. That's why I got the name Dr. Elephant. Mm-hmm. You know, that could have just only been an animation. But the way it's been written now by David Bowers of the team, it's still a huge nose. But you say, my God, there could be a guy like this, a real three-dimensional human being with a nose that big. It'd be a freak. But you could actually have it if it suddenly becomes credible. Mm-hmm. Do you follow? It's
yes.
A unique feeling. Yeah. And that stunned me more than anything else because Astro Boy still looks like Astro Boy. Mm-hmm. The character they're calling Ham Egg, you know who Ham Egg is? Ham Egg, if you look at Astro Boy, episode one, the circus master where Astro Boy sold into a circus, that circus master, I call him Kachitori. His name in Japanese, Tezuka called him Ham Egg. Tezuka loved that name, Ham Egg.
Okay.
That was his idea of humor, Ham Egg. And we have the same humor. I like characteristic names, and so did Tezuka. So, obviously, Dr. Elephant, Dr. Ochanomizu probably harkens back to tea or something. But again, just seeing that character done in a three-dimensional drawing, and far more lifelike than any cartoon that Tezuka ever drew, it just literally blew me away. Ham Egg was there, as I say. Ham Egg still looks like Ham Egg, the character Ham Egg, like Kachitori. Also, by the way, in Kimba, the How Kimba Was Born, episode one, the hunters at the beginning of the show, and the dirty rat who shoots the blast that kills Kimba's father, the one that we call Caesar, that too is the character that Tezuka called Ham Egg. But in Kimba, I called them Viper Snakely. I thought that worked well. Viper Snakely, I thought was good. But I didn't call them Ham Egg. But they are retaining the name Ham Egg, which they've gotten from Japan, obviously. So that character appears in the story they're doing, and he'll be called Ham Egg. And that's how it's going, and I think it's going to be pretty darn good. I'm looking forward to it. I think they're going to do a beautiful, beautiful job. And my guess is that at Tezuka, when the season finished, if it comes up to my expectations, I think he'd be a pretty happy cat.
Great. Awesome.
That is certainly an endorsement.
Yeah, but definitely.
Is there ground zero with everything?
By the way, I say the same thing in the book. That's in the book. Mm-hmm. Everybody read the book. It's a good thing. I'll give you a plug for Imaji. I'm not plugging Imaji. Mm-hmm. I have no financial interest there at all. But I'm so dazzled by the work as I was by Tezuka's original work. Yeah, by the way, I'm easy. I got to tell you, I'm easy. I'm easy, Mark. I'm so easy. I cry at the Hallmark commercials. That's how easy I am. So that picture, I just know it's going to be a good one. And I would just hope that it's got to do better with the box office. I would hope than. The Speed Racer did at the box office. It's got a lot more heart and a lot more warmth. You know, it's a good story, I feel. And I'm glad to write about it in my book, and I spell out all the details in the book. I hope you guys enjoy reading it. It's due out momentarily, and I hope you all enjoy reading it. I know you're going
to
learn something from it, I'm sure.
Yes.
All right. Well, thank you again so much for joining us. We really appreciate it. It's always a pleasure talking
to you. Definitely. Thank
you
so much.
Always learn new stuff.
Good talking to you guys, and thanks for the call. Bye-bye now.
Bye-bye, Mr. Ladd.
Bye.